And let's continue our hippie themed show with Mr. Dave Pace introducing Into the Wild.
This next guy's been Canadian all his life, but we're starting to like him anyway. He's a brother from another mother, even though he's white as Wonder Bread. Hang tight, the Fangoria diplomat, Sir David Gonzo Pace.
Once I built an ivory tower so I could worship from above. When I climbed down to be set free, she took me in again. There's a big hot sun beating on the big people in the big hot world.
When she comes to grief, an asshole recently defined to me as one who demands all interactions on their terms, uncompromising, unwilling to bend even when it may be the proper, polite thing to do. Into the Wild is the incredible true story of asshole Chris McCandless, aka Alexander Supertramp, and his vain quest to enlighten others by rejecting society and attempting to live like some beatified monk. A smug, smarmy, beatified monk. You see, Chris rejects the world around him that he sees as mostly artificial and full of hypocrites and other hopeless cases who have compromised their integrity in one way or the other and gotten lost on the true path to freedom, the path Chris is on. He invents the character Alexander Supertramp and uses that persona to detach himself from society and retreat into the fringes, and indeed into the vast expanses of the wilderness. Along the way, he runs into a cast of characters who all seek to help him and impart their wisdom. But Supertramp always seems a little too good for their tainted advice, and seems to believe he is sagely teaching them lessons on how to live their lives. You know, like an asshole in his early 20s who thinks he's got everything figured out. I hated this fucking movie the first time. I really couldn't stand Chris slash Alex and his holy Bodhidharma act. I couldn't bear that this movie was asking me to root for such a dick. As aligned as I might have been with a lot of his worldview and ideas about the comfortable lies that hold society together and the absurdity of so much of our world, like permits to paddle down a river, Chris himself just left me frustrated. Upon second viewing, I caught things I didn't the first time around. Chiefly, I saw how stunningly beautiful the photography was in this movie. It looks absolutely amazing. I also saw that it was possible director Sean Penn wanted us to know that Chris was an asshole, that so much of this movie was about his narcissism and the ultimate fraud in the whole machine Chris is raging against may be his own. So what makes Chris an asshole, you ask? It's simple. He demands everything on his terms. You can see him judging people. You can feel his contempt for them. He's certain that he is on the purer path. Chris very clearly sees his life in terms of a dramatic narrative. He believes he is performing for an audience he can't see, an invisible audience. The choices he makes are almost all the ones which involve the biggest dramatic gestures, regardless if a third party is there to view the gesture. He poses and postures for photos which are never taken. He's always doing a thing, always has his act on, fearless wanderer, young Buddha on the road. This, of course, means Chris makes decisions which are designed for maximum dramatic effect, and are often manipulative disasters which harm or otherwise play games with the emotions of others. He won't do the polite thing, the social thing. He wants it all on his terms, so he does whatever would contribute most to the mythological character of Alexander Supertramp. His life is now about creating a legend, a great martyrdom. This is what drives his thinking. This is the vanity which keeps him going through ordeal after ordeal. Penn gives us hints that we might be intended to regard him this way. Chris breaks the fourth wall at least twice in the film. Is that Chris unable to resist mugging for his perceived audience? Cannot resist acknowledging them and letting them know everything is going according to plan? So finally, our asshole Chris makes it out to the wilderness of Alaska. He is at the end of his quest for martyrdom. What happens to him here is such a blow to his earlier vanity. We see him finally humbled by the awesome and blind power of nature to kill us dead the second we don't respect it. You see, the idea of the noble savage, the man in tune with nature, and who thinks he can survive in it just because he has the desire to, because he feels entitled to, that shit is a myth. Nature is an indiscriminate killer. It doesn't care how soulfully you stare into its sweeping vistas. It will kill you the fuck dead. Chris seems to think he can make a go of it because he read a few books and it feels right for his narrative, for the legend he is trying to create. Nature doesn't care about his narrative. See, the people who managed to live off the land in places like Alaska, they were experts in wilderness survival, and not from books they read, but hard experiences which usually ended in cruel death. The hardiest, most cunning, most knowledgeable among them survived, and the rest died. This was the eye of the needle people had to pass through in those times, the harsh Darwinian reality. The shelter from all this provided by modern society is, ironically, what allowed Chris to survive, and to spend much of his time reading literature and contemplating the very things which drove him into the woods. Seeing the reality of this sort of wipe the smug grin off of his face was oddly satisfying. If you view the movie this way, you understand the horror he must have confronted at the end, and the fact that he probably understood all too well that it was all his own untruthfulness, his own failure to see his own vanity in all his posturing. To me, this is a far more tragic end. I think the easy way to watch this film is to admire Chris and what he attempts with his transformation into Alex Supertramp. It's easy to be moved by the stirring images and beautiful soundtrack by Eddie Vedder. Easy to buy into the mythology Chris is trying to build up and root for the young rebel who is rejecting a world he doesn't condone. The answers here are easy. Don't like the world? You can walk right out of it. The more difficult reading of this film is to see Chris as an asshole and his quest as a vain myth-making. This view may agree about the state of the world, but sees the solution Chris is after as a romantic gesture for dramatic effect and not a valid response. This is less easy, as it gives us no good answers about how to confront our world. What it really tells us is that if we do so, we should endeavor to know our true intentions for doing so, annihilating the kind of messianic self-regard we get from Chris. It tells us even in the quest for truth, the first casualty is often the very truth who we really are. Chris McCandless was a smart asshole. He knew in those final days he'd made a grave miscalculation, that all his playing at carefree rebellion, all his posing, all his dramatic idiom, it was all a game of his own ego, designed to exalt Alex Supertramp into the fraternity of popular myth. It must have been horrible to know this as you died, cold, alone, and starving. That martyrdom was coming for you, and it wasn't really what you wanted all along. I've come to see now what a spellbinding and astounding work of filmmaking this is. I just wonder if Penn wants me to see it this way or not. As a celebration of the life of an outsider, I felt the movie failed. As a story about arrogance, self-mythologizing, narcissism, and unintended martyrdom, Into the Wild shines. This is also where I feel it's important to point out some things that the movie does not mention or utterly avoids in order to maintain a narrative. Because not even Sean Penn was immune from the urge to make a myth here. So number one, he didn't burn his social security and other cards. They were found with the body. Number two, he had a map of the area he was living at the end. Number three, he did not poison himself accidentally. He starved. He starved because he had no practical experience hunting or preparing game, foraging, or other key survival skills. Number four, his final note was not a reflection on his life and how he has had a great time. He was literally begging to God for help because he was starving to death. The movie glosses over this to suit the McCandless myth. Perhaps we should have watched Herzog's Grizzly Man instead. It had the guts to be openly conflicted. Ultimately, the solution to finding authenticity in life and in living in tune with nature presented by Chris McCandless is in all reality a call for a screeching turn back to days long past and harsh lessons of survival that will be learned in the blood of your friends, neighbors, and loved ones. It's not a true way forward for us as a people. It doesn't answer the tough questions it faces today. It merely has us revert to a state prior to our own ability to even conceive of them. It can only be taken seriously if you are willing to accept the decimation of our population, the deaths of most of the people you know. It is a call for self-genocide. And what is frightening is the film presents Chris as a moral figure for all of this. I'm not cheerleading progress at all costs here. I'm just asking for a way forward that isn't going to involve nations of computer analysts and junior account managers having to try and live in harmony with nature. I'm asking for a solution that isn't me dead in a bus in the middle of nowhere.
Dave definitely raises some challenging questions here, some challenging thoughts, Dave. I got to tell you, I'm kind of seeing it your way. This is about the fourth or fifth time I've watched this, and it's the first time where I kind of saw what you've just talked about for the past few minutes. And it's funny how you talk about, you know, his unpreparedness to really go out into this, into the wild, let's just say, and live and survive. And what I thought was the most important scene in this movie is when he is, he wants to paddle down the river, and someone tells him that he needs a permit to do that, and either that or he could go and get lessons and go, you know, with a group of people. And I've always watched that scene thinking to myself, you know, that's absurd. You know, why can't somebody just simply, you know, paddle down a river if they want to? And it occurred to me during this viewing, and, you know, when he's out there in the wild, I thought to myself, I'm like, you know, he doesn't know what the fuck he's doing. You know, he doesn't know what he's doing. And this obviously leads to his demise. Dave, you definitely... Yeah, man, I'm really intrigued by what you just said. And Max, Joe, please jump in here too. You know, with your thoughts on what Dave just said.
You know what? I actually read the book, Dave. Did he not? Did he have a map? And did he actually starve? Because yeah, the book doesn't say that.
He did. So basically, where I got that information was there was sort of a subsequent investigation, because people had sort of called into question stuff that was in the book. This is prior to it being made into a film. So a lot of the events in the book were sort of called into question, and the author basically got called out for being very selective about who he put forward. And the autopsy results clearly showed he was not poisoned. The autopsy results, their determination was starvation. And what there, and there was no traces of poison. He had the map. They didn't initially find his ID with the body. Mm. It was in his bag. Mm-hmm. And for whatever reason, it was just in a pocket. They hadn't searched. It turned up in a secondary search.
Well, but berry he ate causes the inability to digest.
The book that I
find any of that in his system.
Okay, all right.
The copy of the book that I read had an addendum onto it at the end of the book where it wasn't what he originally thought it was, but it was a mold growing on. It seemed complicated. But I mean, you know, it wasn't the poisonous berry that he originally thought it was, but he did more investigation.
Because he couldn't say it was the poisonous berry that he thought it was, because I was proven false. Right. So he shifts the goalposts, and now it's fucking mold. When really it's just stupid that killed the guy. But also
with the map thing, he does point out, you know, the book doesn't let him get off scot-free. All right. Well, he had to work closely with the family to get that book written, you know. So he maybe was a little bit kind to the kid for a while, on certain things, but he definitely put out that the kid didn't have the proper respect for nature. You know, he definitely did that and pointed out the absurdity of the dude going in there full of hubris, thinking that he could take over. And that caused a lot of anger when this guy dude's Krakauer's first article came out in Outdoor Magazine. But that said, one of the things that he did point out was that if he had a map, he would have realized, and this is something they glossed over for sure in the movie, was that less than 2 miles south of on the river was a cord that was going over the river for one reason or another. I think hunters put it up there or something. And if he knew that that was there, he would have been free. Like, he was essentially 2 miles away from civilization, you know? And then like 2 miles north, there were cabins with food in it. So if he had a map, he would have probably survived.
That was the point, was that he did have a map. They found the map. with him. Yeah.
And well,
the thing that I find egregious, like, I mean, had the map, didn't have the map, you know, berries, no berries, whatever. What I find interesting is how they changed his final words. Because the final words that they put in the film, and I can't speak to the book, but the final words they put into the film are all like, I've had a good life.
Right.
And all this stuff. And when in fact, his last notes at that place were like, God help me.
It wasn't God help me. It was, I'm in search of berries. I'm starving. I need help. This is not a joke.
Well,
wait here.
Okay, fine. Take the God out of me.
But you know what? But one thing though, Dave, is that I agree with you about all his posturing and stuff. And I do want to speak to that in a second, but when he carved his name into that bus or whatever, he signed his real name, which was very telling, and which is actually what I think is the point of the film, is that yes, this guy's got this young adult man hubris and this rigidity of views, and basically he's an asshole, you know. But I think at the end, and this is something that he had underlined in Tolstoy's one of Tolstoy's book, I think it was Family Happiness or something, or whatever the Tolstoy book was. And I think this is the exact point of the film, was that to paraphrase, it was something like, happiness is only real when it's shared,
right.
You know? And so here's this dude. And so what we're getting, in my opinion anyway, is a personal narrative of a kid, like a lot of kids, who get to adulthood and see the hypocrisy of the world and demand that and lash out at it with anger and rigid ideology. And when they to find their own identity or to resolve some Oedipal complex, as this kid was obviously doing with his parents, because his father was a bigamist essentially when he was a kid. So when he found that out when he was older, he rebelled hugely, and he just dropped out as a rebellion, as a way of carving out his own identity. And he did it so they couldn't stop. He was a kid who was under strict control and great expectations by his parents.
Well, the film leads you to believe that the dropout was due to the parents, mostly. More than anything
it,
else.
It was. The whole thing is due to his... He was... His whole 3 years of that... His ranting and raving going across the country...
You're kind of saying that it was a general disdain for contemporary society.
No, I think it was more a rebellion against his father.
Because that's how... I never read the book, but the way Sean Penn plays this is that it...
He uses authority in society, you know, authority figures and patriarchal society as a substitute for his father, and he's trying to work it out. He just took it too far, and you know, thought he would, like a lot of kids, he could drive too fast, or you know, like any kid who's in their late teens or whatever. But I think that the key to this film, and to what he was probably going to learn if he didn't die out there, was that, you know, to be a little more giving. And they do give that. I think that's actually the message of the film is, you know, he's like, you know what? I'm lonely and I need people and I can't find be happy on my own. So he learned an important lesson here where he touched on, he was shunning.
I don't know. I mean, like he cut, you know, even in the last person he comes across before he goes out into the Alaskan wild, he's still leaving in the middle of the night like he did with the hippie couple.
He didn't learn it until he was by his own when he was in the wild.
I think it was in the bus that he grew and developed as a character, right? I mean,
right, and he went into the wild to learn that. And there's one scene, the most important scene of the film, is when he's walking away from the bus. And he's like, he's learned that lesson. Like he's going to back to rejoin society. And this dude's whole thing was he had jobs all along the way and all this stuff. And his letters to the people in his life were basically that, you know, he's going to do this for another year or so. And I think he had like I was when I was a kid, that every intention to, you know, live life, among other people. And you see it, Tom, right when he's walking, he's so happy because he just came to the realization that, you know what, I need to be a little bit more pliable, a little bit forgiving, and I need people, you know. And it's an important lesson. And the irony is that he pushed himself there and he couldn't make it back, you know.
Right. You know, Max has been real quiet. I know that this film has had an effect on him recently. Max, you want to weigh in here, buddy?
Yeah, I wasn't watching a documentary about this guy. I was watching a dramatic film directed by Madman Sean Penn. This is a very extreme dude with very extreme POVs. You could tell that, you know, he really loved the story he was telling. It was, like, personal for this guy. And it was personal for me in a million ways. And I saw the asshole, Dave. I really did, which was amazing because I think the first time I saw the film, I think I was just like, I was so overwhelmed by the emotionality of the thing. I was that guy that was bought and sold by the music and right. the acting and the feelings and the nature because right. I have been a camper my whole life. I know Joe camps. I don't know if Tom camps very much. You don't camp, do you, Tom?
Oh, no, not a camper, but boy, I really love watching it on the television screen.
Well, yeah, because you feel like you're going on this epic journey. But I did see the dick, and you know where I saw the dick most, and it hurt, but at the same time I loved him? You see it in Catherine Keener's eyes. You see it yes. in the supporting characters. You see it when he twists the fat hippie stomach. Work on that. And the guy's like, oh, man, why do you got to be such a dick? It's in his face. When Hal Holbrook just wants to share a moment, go to breakfast, he brings him the basket of stuff at 3 a.m. And he's like, you know, who the fuck do you think you are? I was in the army. I make leather stuff now because I've lived all that. But I came back to reality. Clearly, right. this kid is right. kind of going cuckoo throughout this whole thing. You know what I mean?
Well, you know what? The funny thing about that, Max, is that he touches all these people and he gives them something that they need. And the thing is that they can't give him what he needs at that moment because he needs to find it for himself.
Oh, know? Yeah, which like, is totally like they frustrating. Love this
kid. Yeah. Yeah, they love this kid. And he just... Because of, I think, what happened with his parents or whatever in the film, I guess, is his rigid ideologies. is that he can't drive what he can't get what he needs from those people, you know?
Hey guys, is there, let me, I'm sorry, because he was just talking about Catherine Keener character, and I never picked up on this, but is there something more like motherly and sonly to this relationship, or am I just going like a little cuckoo here?
No, I think so, absolutely. I don't think there's sexual at all.
Okay, go on, Joe.
What Sean Penn does in the film is divides the chapters up, and I believe this is to a Tolstoy book as well, but he calls it childhood, manhood, whatever it was, or birth.
Birth, and, yeah.
Yeah, so that chapter is early on, and it's labeled birth, and this was something that wasn't in the book, but in the real couple that he met had lost or she had become estranged from her son, so there was absolutely a mother-son relationship there, you know.
So that's where it was at. There was nothing. You don't think that there was anything else going on between those two?
No, and interestingly, and they only touch upon this a very little bit in the, and this is one of the oddest scenes in the film, is that he's celibate, you know, willfully celibate, and it's hard to tell really what's going on there, but he was celibate in real life, and you know that one scene where Kristen Stewart is just there with those eyes.
How could he not fuck Kristen Stewart? That's what I don't understand.
Yeah. I think the dude had a serious Oedipal issues going on, man, and he was just having he was a bit of a tragedy, you know.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, it's. To live. Go on, Joe. I'm sorry.
I interject? This goes a lot to what we were just talking about, you know, rigid ideologies and living on your own and all this stuff. But it's a quote from Emerson real quick, because it's very pertinent here. So it is easy in the world to live after the world's opinion. It is easy in solitude to live after your own. But the great man is he who, in the midst of the crowd, keeps with perfect sweetness the independence of solitude. And that I think is the lesson that kind of sums up what this kid learned, and actually, you know, what I learned when I was a kid his age, is that, you know, you could be your own prick and your own asshole, and it's very easy to do that unless you die, or you can go along with the crowd, and it's even easier to do that. But maybe one of the greatest things that you might try to do in this life is to maintain your individuality and live among your brothers and sisters, you know?
Yeah, well, as opposed to, like, you know, living an act. Yeah, definitely, Joe. Go on, man.
I didn't say anything.
Oh, it was Dave.
Oh, go
sorry.
On,
yeah, well, I was just going to say, one of the reasons that I think I view the film the way I do is because we know our own.
Right.
You know, like I recognize a guy who, I mean, it took me a long time in my life to figure out that a lot of the decisions I made over the years weren't good decisions, and weren't made because I was like, I'm going to consciously make a bad decision or I don't know better. It was literally, this is more interesting. This is going to produce a more interesting result.
Right.
And you're almost in a way, I tended to see it as sort of imagining myself a character in some novel. And I would imagine, like, what would you do? Because you wouldn't make the conventional choice. You'd make a different choice.
But, Dave, isn't the wrong decision always far more interesting?
Of course it is.
Always, right?
And this is why I think that I just, I don't know, when I see this guy, I'm like, I know this guy really well, because, yeah, you know, early in my life, that's what I was doing, you know, I wouldn't have been dead in a bus, you know, alone in Alaska, but, you know, it was, things were very close to not ending well for me, you know, and making a lot of really, really horrible decisions, purely for the purpose of myth making, purely because I wanted to be more than what I was.
So didn't you feel like, as from that vantage point, didn't you feel a little bit sorry for this kid that he's
doing?
Sure, I
did. Yeah, of course.
You know what I mean? Like, what, like, look, what pain it causes. What pain is at the bottom of the decision to make bad choices or you know, bad decisions or cast off on your own? You know.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, I mean, I guess my review is kind of condemning, but. You know, ultimately, I get this guy quite a bit.
Well, let me pose an alternate ending here, even though this is based on real life. What if, like what I was saying when he underlined that passage in Tolstoy, and he came to this understanding that he needs to go and be forgiven or ask for forgiveness and, you know, be more lenient on people who don't have as high you know, ethical or moral views of the world or whatever, and he's just more accepting of people, and that river wasn't overflowing, and he got back over the river and he walked back into society. Oh. And he went and he talked to the people that he touched in their life and lived among them, and like, don't you think that that's what was going to happen? Or and how would that be, make the film, you know?
I don't know. You think he was prepared to go back to his mom and dad and forgive?
I don't know about his mom and dad.
Because if he can't do that, there's no way he could have moved on with anything else, Joe.
You're right. I know. Well, who knows? I mean, maybe. But I think that he certainly would have been able to do that with the other people in his life, you know?
Here's what I think. I think that a big part of what led him to the revelation about his life and where it had brought him was fear.
Right.
And yeah, I think the whole march back to civilization, he would have been like, man, I'm gonna call my mom. I'm gonna, you know, consider talking to dad. I'm definitely gonna reach out to my sister. And, you know, I'm gonna try and do some things right. But I think by the time he got to safety, he'd miss being Super Tramp.
I do know. Well, let me just pose a quick anecdote about myself here, is that I've cast off across the country four times I've done it without really knowing what was going to happen in the next couple of weeks. Like, I packed my shit into a car and
with minimal means, minimal dollar.
With I put everything into a 2-seater car with $1,000 and I left not knowing anybody in California, you know, twice I did that. And just, I just know that when looking back now, you know, I've learned the lesson that this kid was about to learn or was in the process of learning while he was dying. I learned that I have great happiness right now, you know, in my life. And though I don't regret what I did or leaving the people, but I do. And at the same time, I'm glad that I've reconciled my relationships from my childhood. And I do miss that kid, but it's not like I have this weird, crazy urge to escape my family right now to go hit back on the road. I mean, I learned a lesson. I've learned it well, you know, and I've become a better person for it. And that's why I feel so for this kid, even as much of an asshole as he is, because I guess like most young men, you know, who are disillusioned with the society that they're born into or have furious rage against their parents. You know, I mean,
this is a beyond furious show.
You know, this kid just had the courage of his convictions. You know, I was never, you know, personally, I was never one to, I'll always love nature, but I was just happy enough to be running around the country and, you know, living in San Diego and not, you know, talking to my parents for a year.
So, Joe, when you packed up the car and you headed out west, you landed in San Diego, right?
Yeah, well, via New Orleans and traveling around the
$1,000.
$1,000.
Okay, so you basically camped most of the time or slept in your car.
Yes, camped and slept in my car. And when I got to San Diego, we had $500. We had like $400 each. I went with one of my buddies and we slept in a campground for like 2 weeks before we found
an
apartment.
Were you looking for like a work or any kind of odd job or...
I did.
You had a diploma, right?
Delivered
pizza. You had a Rutgers.
No, I left after my freshman. Here's what happened. After my freshman year of college, I was doing liberal arts and I was like, you know what? Fuck this. I was like, I'm going to either study something that I want to study or I'm not going to study anything at all. So I went, I dropped my portfolio that I had built in high school off at the art school. I packed my shit and I left. And I didn't hear until like 3 weeks before the semester started that I got into the art school. So,
gross.
Yeah. So I just so I basically did that again. I friggin' packed up with a girl and drove across the country again and landed in on campus a day before classes started.
Wow.
Like, yeah, dude. I mean,
Teenager though.
I was 18, yeah.
Jeez Louise. Yo, Max, have you ever done anything like that, man?
Yes, I've done the cross-country thing. I totally loved hearing Joe talk about that. It made my wanderlust throb.
So, Max, Michigan to California, was it? Did you and the family drive?
Oh, well, that was when I was a kid from Michigan to California.
How young?
Well, I was, gosh, 7 then we drove, but no.
Do you remember any of that experience?
Well, I'd rather talk about when I did it again when I was older, so I have done it twice.
All right, let's do it then.
In 95, I drove, and let me tell you something. I stopped in New Orleans, but here's the best thing. We drove through Texas. Joe, did you drive through Texas?
Yeah, one time I did.
Oh, my God. It is... 55 days of nothing.
I know, it's a huge state.
But you start to discover the sidelines. So we decided, simply because of wine, or are they making any wine in Texas? So we found this little town called Kerrville, which just so happened to be right off the highway, you know. And then next thing you know, we're inside this awesome little wine bar on a river talking to these awesome people from Kerrville. For like 10 minutes, my wife and I are like, fuck LA. Let's just plant here. Let's just stop here, you know. Yeah, I've driven across country a few times, but I got to tell you, the most into the wildy thing I've ever done was with my Uncle Patrick, who I talked about in my ridiculous Easy Rider review if anyone was listening, but that dude is the quintessential, like, who this kid was, but he still is that guy, and he's living in Portland, Oregon now, but he was the guy that would seriously bypass the fences at Yosemite National Park. Fuck fences, man. Don't listen to fences, man. Fuck that. Follow me. And we would backpack, and we wound up in terrain that we did not belong in, just like Dave says, you know. Like, we had 3 bear visits, and the bears got bigger and bigger and bigger throughout the course of the evening, and we didn't even tie our food to the tree. And I was only, like, 10 years old then, so my Uncle Pat is jumping out of a tent at 5 in the morning, and there's this giant black bear on our sight, and he's, you know, his white socks are hanging off his feet, and he's throwing cans of corn at this thing.
Jeez.
You know, and I'm in the tent being quiet, you know, shitting my pants with my action figures and comic books in the tent. And we are in a place that we are not supposed to be. We were in a van for 2 weeks in Yosemite breaking rules. He taught me how to break rules.
That's great.
You know, he's such a crazy awesome uncle. But, you know, it's so funny. Let me just say one thing about the kid. And again, I really admire Dave's take on it, because it was a really interesting perspective, because I have been romanticizing this film. And it's like, how do you hate a kid that stands before nature in awe like that and cries the way he does? How do you, you know, and Emil Hirsch, I mean, where is this kid? He came out of nowhere. I think he's made a few films, but this was like his... This should have been his Oscar winner, but I guess, was he even nominated? I don't remember, but I mean, this was an extraordinary performance, I thought. Am I wrong?
No, it is. Yeah, it is. I know Hal Holbrook was nominated for Best Supporting Actor. I'm not sure if Hirsch did it. And, you know, you're so right, Max. Hirsch has pretty much been off the radar, hasn't he, the past few years?
Honestly, the last time I saw him was in some tabloid thing online where he was pissing on a plant outside of a nightclub.
Really?
Yeah.
He was on. He was in that movie Milk a couple years ago, I think.
That's right. He was in Gus Van Sant's Milk. Yeah, but that was still four. That was like four years ago.
Yeah, that was a few years ago.
It was right around the same time as Into the Wild. It was like 2008, 2009.
Yeah.
And then before that, before Into the Wild, the only thing I really remembered him in was in Cassavetes' son's movie, Alpha Dog.
Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
That's a great movie.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like Alpha Dog a lot. Yeah, he played the Johnny Truelove character. He was really, you know, he was really insane in that movie.
Listen, fellas, you're all in your 30s, right?
Yeah.
For now.
Isn't Dave, like, the youngest?
Yeah, Dave's, like, 20.
I wish.
Well, you guys haven't really gone through midlife crisis yet, and a lot of people think it's bullshit, and maybe it is for a lot of dudes, but right now I think I might be kind of teetering around it. I thought I had some really bad spout of it in 2010 where it was just like, oh my god, I'm such a fucking loser and whatever, but especially with this theme.
So is your midlife crisis making you want to go and buy stuff, expensive stuff like convertibles and stuff?
Oh god,
what,
no.
What exactly does it entail for you, Max, the midlife crisis?
None of that stuff, not material things. I mean, maybe the motorcycle a little bit, but I'm telling you guys, this theme, this wanderlust theme, these films, Easy Rider, Into the Wild, I mean, they touch upon something so personal for me, and I can't figure it out. I can't figure it out what it is, but it's like I'm happy that I still have the True Grit. Like, you know, it used to be that the counselor and I would take, like, these trips over to Catalina Island. And we would go by bike, and we would have everything on our backs and a bike. You get off at Catalina Island, you ride all the way up to the top of the island, and there's buffalo up there. And there's a little campground there that's really great. And you set up camp, and you ride back into town, and you get your supplies, and you ride back up, and you camp on an island in the middle of the ocean. And I haven't done that in a while, you know? And I mean, I'm always trying to get out with the wife and everything, and it's mostly up and down the coast right now. But yeah, there's just that thing of like that, I don't know, Matt. It's so funny. Let me just say this. When I was that kid's age and everyone's telling me I had to go to Europe, I thought they were full of shit. I'm like, I don't ever need to go to fucking Europe. I got everything I need right here. Well, that's the dumbest thing I could have ever thought. Because once I did finally go to Europe, what, are you kidding me? I went to France. I went to Italy. I went to Spain. I lost my mind over there.
It's a beautiful country. This is a beautiful country, though, man. I've only been to Italy once, but just driving across this freaking country is amazing, man. It's just this movie just reminded me of it so much. Just the scenery going from different landscapes and complete. It's like going to completely different worlds from state to state. I mean,
I've
just
talked
gorgeous.
To Europeans that really rave about the American landscape.
Yeah,
it's gorgeous. Tom, you've never been west of the Mississippi, huh?
No. I mean, I honestly, you know, I've never even made it out to Pittsburgh.
do you have any desire to get
absolutely on the road? Yeah, I do, man. You know, I just, you know, I haven't done it. Yeah, you know, I just was on a plane for the first time, like, just a
wait, when?
Oh, yeah,
like 3 or 4 years ago.
Where did you fly to?
Puerto Rico.
Hey, that's pretty good.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun.
What was it like down in Puerto Rico for you?
It was exhilarating. I mean, I felt like I was going to fall off the planet. Like, I'd never been, like, anywhere before in my life, it's, you know, ever. And, you know, for me to get on a plane, and I have, like, a tremendous fear of flying and heights. So for me to get on that plane, to go down there and spend, you know, 7 days in Rincon, Puerto Rico was a big deal, man. And it was gorgeous. It was worth it, man. Beautiful.
Yeah, it's so true what Joe was saying about the film. You really do feel like you're going on this epic adventure, and by the end, it's you're exhausted, you're tired, you're emotional. You know, it's the power of Penn's direction, I think. I mean, holy shit. Yeah, you
obviously feel so much for this guy, for this story.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah, and I love how you're always meeting these ridiculous characters on the road. Some of them are so out there, and then how about the foreign couple? There's that little Swedish Spicoli right there, randomly in the down the river.
Well, it's so great, man. I you know, it's the same deal with Easy Rider, is, you know, the road as, like, narrative. I think it's called the river as narrative or something like that. There's a French term for it or whatever. But it's not, it's like a, almost like a plotless film. And the story is just made up by the people that you kind of happen upon along the way. It's, you know, it's kind of started with the Odyssey a million years ago. And Huckleberry Finn is maybe the best road story ever told, man. It's just beautiful. It's something that's very American, you know, just hitting the road. But that said, I'm really curious about the landscape in Canada. I've always had in the back of my head that I'd love to get up there.
I would love
and take
to
like
to
3 weeks to drive across there.
Yeah.
Dave, what's going on up there? Have you taken road trips around?
Yeah, it's all right.
Fucking Dave.
No, I'm fucking with you. No, it's, yeah. I mean, I've driven. We went out to the East Coast, to Prince Edward Island, and all that when I was younger. That was beautiful. It was amazing. I especially enjoyed Quebec. Been to Quebec. I've never been to Montreal though, but I've been to Quebec City and a few other places in northern Quebec, and it's beautiful.
Go
on, Joe.
I was just going to say, Canada is just such a huge, it just looks like such a massive country that
it is.
There's so much space to go and explore, you know, it's like almost overwhelming, it seems.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's very easy, like, you can just walk out there, and there's nothing, you know, right. Like, you can go to places, you know, you're back, you know, I was going to take a job at a place where I would have to, like, fly in by helicopter because there's just no roads there. You would take a helicopter in every 2 weeks or whatever, and you'd work 2 weeks on and 2 weeks off.
Oh, that would be great.
And hey, that's just how it is.
Hey, Dave, what is that country up there? Because I crossed the border into Canada and camped with my other uncle, the brother of the crazy uncle I was talking about. And we went up through Charlevoix, Michigan, and it's above Michigan, but to the west. And it's some of the most miraculous terrain. I guess it's the Great Lakes still.
Yeah, so it would probably be like, that's probably around on like Ontario, Manitoba.
Oh, that sounds familiar. And you had to take like a canoe to go around a bluff to get to the campsite. It's not like you pull up your car to the campsite. All right, kids, everyone out. You know, it was gnarly.
Yeah, there's a lot of gnarliness that shit like that.
Yeah, I don't want to ever get too old to get gnarly because I've been gnarly. And before I forget, Joe, you talked about Easy Rider and you talked about meeting people, and we were talking about meeting people on the road. How about that scene in Easy Rider where Captain America and Billy pull up to that farm and they're just hanging with that dude and
so great.
And it's so simple. And Peter Fonda is just looking at that guy. He's like, this is some spread you got here, man. No, you should be really proud. And the guy's like, yeah, whatever, you know, she's a spread. And he, no, man, seriously, you should be proud, man. You're living off the land. You're living the dream, man. You're doing it your way. That's it.
That is it, man. That's the whole, like, at the center of both of these films is, or all three of these films. I mean, that's the ideology. Somewhere along the way, the hippie ideal got friggin' confused as hell. But just to live honestly and live simply, you know what I mean? And not be obsessed with all this stuff. But that's like at the heart of all of these films, I feel, you know? But all of the films sort of just show how alienated or how far from the original ideology the hippies came, you know. I guess when there's no war to fight, you lose your purpose, your sense of purpose, and lose focus.
All right, dudes, I want to start wrapping up our Into the Wild review, and we're going to do some ratings right now. We're going to start with Mr. Max Cook. Avoid, rent, purchase. Max, what are you telling these people?
Rent this film, buy the soundtrack.
Ooh, Joseph.
Yeah, I'm a fan of that soundtrack too, and I have it. I would say that if you're a DVD collector, this is definitely an own film. I really love it.
Max, do you own it?
Oh, yes. Why? I got a SAG screener. It was sent to my mailbox, and I had to vote. I voted for Hal Holbrook, though.
Good for you.
Thank you, Tom. So I pulled out my screener.
I don't even remember who Hal Holbrook was up against. Was that the Heath Ledger year?
Oh. I don't know.
I don't remember. Pace, what about you? Avoid, rent, buy?
I think you should at least rent it, if not buy it. I know my review is maybe harsh, but I think it's, you know, I think it's a great film.
Yeah, it is a great film. And I don't think your review doesn't at all, you know,
no,
dismiss the fact that it's a great film.
It's just a great take.
Yeah, you're just talking about the character. You know, the character, in your opinion, is an asshole.
Dave, you're the rock and roll reviewer on this show because I was assigned Sinister. You wanted to do Sinister. I did my Sinister, and it was completely upstaged by your epic 80-minute Sinister review.
And then a fan
on the fan page goes and kisses your ass about your Sinister review. And I'm like,
wait, somebody kissed my ass?
I'm left blowing in the breeze. Like,
Joe, this is what happened, right? Because Joe, you weren't on the first like half hour of that show. I introduced the show. Max comes in with this Sinister review, and then basically Dave just goes, "Yeah, fuck that shit."
Yeah, and I'm like, I worked really hard on that review. I was like, because I'm always insecure about my reviews on the show. I'm like, I worked really hard. I feel good about this one. Epic fart onto Dave's 90-minute questions. I have 20 questions that I'm not really going to ask my co-hosts. I'm just going to ask the universe.
And if anybody ever thinks that Dave is just going on a bit too long, just check the comment boards because they obviously love it.
Yeah. Hey, tell Dave I love what he said about Sinister. I'm like, all right, fine.
Well, actually, I do want to extend the compliment, Dave, because the guy, Claude, who, you know, edits the show once in a while, he didn't edit that show particularly, but he was listening to the clip and he's like, he sent me an email. He's like, I really like when Dave goes nuts on movies. Makes for good radio.
I get texts from my brother about the show, Jeffrey, you know, who's been on the show, about Dave. And he just loves it when Dave goes off on his rants. He's a big fan. So.
I gotta get angry. I have to find a movie to get angry about.
It helps. Get pissed off.
You know what? I think it was just the last times I just start arguing with people, and I gotta find a way to do that without.
Yeah, you need to get angry at a movie as opposed to a female guest.
Oh, Tom, the biggest argument was when I argued with you with Fellini after we were fighting about Billy all day. Remember that? And then I started yelling at you about Federico Fellini of all people. It's fucking ridiculous.
Yo, Max, what about before? What was it, the show or two ago when Joe came on and he was mad at us?
Oh, my God. I lost my mind. Is that the one where I pitched a fit and hung up on you guys?
Well, we were recording the show on April 1st, Max. And listen, I didn't even say anything to you. I was upset with Tom, first of all. And I shouldn't have been. It was silly of me to be upset, first of all. But you got on and I was like, guys, I really...
That.
I was really pissed off, and I was just like, I just was letting something fester and stew and everything. So I get on, and Max is, and I didn't reply to one of Max's emails or something like that.
No, you didn't reply at all.
I didn't reply at all. I know. I was just stewing in my anger or whatever. But anyway, we get on before the show, and I was like, all right, let's just do the fucking show or whatever, you know. And then Max is like, what is going on, Joe?
Yeah.
And then he goes, you're ignoring my emails. I don't need to be. And then he hangs up.
Referred to you as listen. Max must have referred to Joe as being used the word unprofessional.
Yeah, we're all professional.
Unprofessional.
But anyway, so Max, the idea
is so unprofessional.
You know what we were going to do, Max, was just do the whole first review and have Tom not ask you one question about it, because we realized that the worst thing that we could ever do to you was just ignore you. The worst thing anybody could do to Max is just not pay attention to him. So I thought How funny would it have been if we just did the whole Wanderlust and just not even asked you any questions, just went on to the next movie review?
That's great.
Here's the thing. I, Joe, secretly went to Max. I said, listen, let's play. And this is after you suggested that we do that to Max. I said, Max, let's play an April Fool's joke on the show, you know, with Joe Christiana. And I was going to take whoever had the better idea.
What did Max come up with?
Somebody would have been waiting for me to do that. But Max never came up with anything. So
no, because I was too busy freaking out that we were miscommunicating on which show I was appearing on. And thank God, you don't have to listen to me for a while.
Oh, Max is going to be off on the next episode, guys.
I'm looking forward to guests.
And for all the Cutting Room fans out there, Billy Barassa, 2 in a row coming up, Joseph.
Oh, boy. Looking forward to that.
The man has come down from the mountain.
he's handing down his favors from the mountain.
Mountaintop. Oh, that's great, Tom.
True. Handing them down. Billy Barassa will be handing
down.
We
will all gather at his feet. And he will impart film wisdom upon us.
What was that?
Hey, Tom. Hey, Tom, I feel like you didn't really, you really said you really love this movie a lot. I feel like you didn't, Into the Wild, I feel like you didn't really talk about it much, unfortunately, with the technical difficulties.
No, I've owned it, Joe, and I've watched it probably, you know, like I said, it's probably like my fourth or fifth time, and it's, you know, it's a very moving film. It's a very beautiful film, and I love Sean Penn. I mean, Sean Penn, I totally dig The Pledge, and I love The Crossing Guard. It always moves me in different ways whenever I watch this movie, Joe. It's, you know, it's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, Dave's review was really right on, man, because it was just until this time that I saw it when I started. Well, when I read the book, it's a lot easier to be objective about somebody when you're reading
the
book.
Start over, Joe. Joe, start over. It was this time with Dave's review.
Well, you know, Dave's review was really timely because it was this viewing of it. I think it was the third time I've seen the film that I actually started considering the dude as, you know, kind of a dickhead. And I think reading the book, you know, started pointing that out to me too, because you could be a little bit more objective in your judgments when, you know, you have the time to turn pages and stuff. And I definitely saw that, but I still empathize with the guy greatly.
Yeah. You know? Well, it's hard not to, you know, Joe, it really isn't, but I, hello?
Yeah.
Oh, no, because you were just going out before. Can you hear me?
Okay, all so right. Joe asked you if you wanted to edit the show, and your answer is go.
Fuck no. Never. Don't we pay somebody to do that, Joe?
No. If there's going to be a lot of scissor sound effects in this friggin' show, listeners, and my apologies for that, but we had severe technical difficulties.
Well, you know what you should do, Joe? And, you know, I'm just suggesting, just play, like, little excerpts of hippie songs.
Just out of nowhere? Come
just
on.
Do it, man. Randomly. Else have anything to say tonight?
Oh, excuse the interruption, gang, but in the midst of the technical fiasco of recording this episode, I totally forgot to mention that I'm going to trail us out with a song from one of my old buddies, Ron Buga. Ronnie, like me, is an ex-neo hippie, and his tune Human seems appropriate to finish this up this episode. I will also post his video along with the show notes. I'm also going to put up all the music tracks that you're hearing during this one, so go over to our website and check that out. Back to you, Tom.
Always a pleasure, boys. Seriously, and have fun on the... I'm going to really try to make the show after the next show, but could be a problem.
Really? So you might be taking two shows off in a row.
It could be. So stand by, Dave Pace. Won't matter anyway, because I'll be assigned Enemy Mine, and then I'll give my review of Enemy Mine, and then Dave Pace, I have a few things to say about Enemy Mine. And then it'll be 2 hours of his Enemy Mine, and everyone will be talking about his Enemy Mine.
Look, he's already saying, I love Enemy Mine.
I have nothing bad to say about Enemy Mine.
Max, I want you on that show. You have to make it. I don't want two shows without Max Cook. I don't think the Cutting Room World could handle it.
I don't know. Is it too late to change my recommendation to buy? Because this film, and now I want to go watch it again.
All right, gentlemen, that's going to do it for today. The Cutting Room Movie Podcast is produced by Joseph Christiana and Thomas Tetloff, and this episode edited by Mr. Joseph Christiana. I would like to remind everyone that they can like us on Facebook at the Cutting Room fan page, and you can also follow me, Thomas Tetloff, on Twitter at Cutting Room Show. You can also check us out at thecuttingroompodcast.com or subscribe to us via iTunes. Our next episode without Max Cook will be out Thursday, April 25th. And our theme will be Gaspar Noé Films. And we will review two of his movies, including I Stand Alone and Enter the Void. Dave Pace, the greatest reviewer in the history of film reviews, will also give you his new DVD release review of the 2011 film Manborg. Until then, we are over and we are out. Peace.
You are
satisfy more of your strange desires, the Cutting Room Movie Podcast, we do chicken right.
Hello?
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 I'm here.
How's that sound?
Hello? You sound a little fuzzy.
Me?
I think.
Hello, no, I'm talking right now? Yeah?
Terrible.
Terrible?
Yeah. Do me a favor. Try calling. Don't go back and hit the thing where everybody gets called at once. Just go start a whole new thing. Call one person at a time and bring them in one at a time.
Okay.
Okay. Try that. Thank you.